Have you ever wondered what space smells like? You might expect a vast, odorless void, but it turns out that may not be the case. If you guessed cosmic barbecue, you're not far off. Space does have a smell, and that smell may be a little more confirmation for the electric universe model of cosmology. Let's investigate. There aren't a lot of predictions about the smell of space to be found. I couldn't find a thing that predates 1960, and that's probably for good reason. No air in a vacuum means nothing to carry a scent. In fact, about the only place you could find it mentioned would be in science fiction. For example, Arthur C. Clarke, in his 1953 novel Childhood's End, the story says that there's no smell or taste to space, and that it was all outside the range of human senses. Clark's description is hard to argue with, and not many others have had much to say on the subject. But then some astronauts did some spacewalking, and it turns out space may have a scent after all. What kind, you ask? Ozone, burnt steak, and arc welding fumes. Here are a few quotes from the lucky few who have gone there and back again. Donald R. Pettit, a chemical engineer and NASA astronomer with 13 spacewalks and 370 days in space, said, quote,
"Each time when I repress the airlock, open the hatch, and welcome two tired workers inside, a peculiar odor tickled my olfactory senses. At first I couldn't quite place it. It must have come from the air ducts that repress the compartment. Then I noticed this smell was on their suit, helmet, gloves, and tools. It was more pronounced on fabrics than on metal or plastic surfaces. Best description I can come up with it is metallic. A rather pleasant, sweet metallic sensation. It reminded me of my college summers where I labored for many hours with an arc welding torch, repairing heavy equipment for a small logging outfit. It reminded me of pleasant, sweet-smelling welding fumes. That is the smell of space."
End quote. Take note of pleasant, sweet-smelling welding fumes. It's important. Three-time spacewalker and NASA astronaut Thomas Jones has put it, quote,
"Space carries a distinct odor of ozone, a faint, acrid smell. Smells a little like gunpowder. It is sulfurous."
End quote. Steve Pierce, the chemist behind NASA's Ode to Space fragrance project, whose job was to recreate the smell of space for training purposes, said, quote,
"Overall, astronauts often compare the smell of space to hot metal, burnt meat, burnt cakes, spent gunpowder, and welding of metal."
End quote. To those who work around welders, high voltage, or something like Ben Hyde's Spark Science Lab, this is a familiar bouquet. The experts theorize these smells have more to do with chemical reactions that occur when rocket ships and spacemen, all covered in atmosphere and chemicals, come under the lethal barrage of naked space, and it is certainly a plausible argument. But there are a few clues that suggest these smells may have less to do with the stuff astronauts brought, and more to do with what landed on them while they were spacewalking. So what else is out there that could be making the airlock smell like a welding shop? Well, lest we forget, space is not empty. According to the NASA article, The Solar Wind, Earth orbit particle density is around 3 to 10 particles per cubic centimeter, more than enough space dust to collect all over your pumpkin soup. So we've got two potential sources for these smells. And to explore what it means for our space models, first let's talk about why arc welding smells like arc welding. When the electric arc interacts with the air, it can split oxygen molecules into individual atoms, which then can combine with other oxygen molecules to form ozone. Ozone is formed by electrical discharges, and that fresh, invigorating air is what we all experience during a lightning storm. It's one of the primary contributors to the smell of arc welding. And when it touches metal, it'll vaporize the particles, which will then interact with the oxygen to form metal oxides. This same process is occurring with various metals, the flux, and even the gases used in welding, and makes a valid argument for the smells in the airlock. Turns out that you can arc weld without oxygen at all, either by inert gas shielding, i.e. gases that don't react like volatile oxygen, or by actually just welding in a vacuum. When you do, the primary smell could come from the vaporization of the metal itself. You might notice a metallic, sometimes sweet, or acrid smell from the metal vapors. These odors are from the direct thermal decomposition of the metal rather than reactions with oxygen. A sweet smell, much as Dr. Pettit experienced. So what's different about the electric sun, as opposed to the clunky old non-predictive version we used to believe in, back in the dark ages of so-called modern cosmology? The great EU pioneer Ralph Jurgens, who introduced the concept of the electrically powered sun in August 1972, said, quote,
"The known characteristics of the interplanetary medium suggest that not only the sun and planets are electrically charged, but that the sun itself is the focus of a cosmic electric discharge, the probable source of all of its radiant energy."
End quote. And that radiant energy is from fusion, not happening at the core, but right there on the surface, in front of our eyes, where the chemical reaction meets the fuel source. That's right, fuel source. In the EU model, stars are externally powered, and that power is supplied by the huge interstellar power lines of plasma running through their solar systems. A Birkeland current, just like the ones powering the aurora, but bigger. Where's all that power coming from? We just don't know. But it's there, and at the moment, we can only speculate on the hows and whys. Our solar system, like most of the ones we see, is located at a pinch point in our local Birkeland current. Cut a cross-section, and it looks like concentric rings of counter-rotating plasma. The magnetic fields begin to compress and concentrate that plasma, leading to increased charge density and rising temperatures. Increased ionization means more free electrons and ions available to conduct juice and get it flowing. These Z-pinches happen at all different scales, like most things electric. But when it happens at the scale of our solar system, you get ignition, an arc-mode star. In this model, the fusion is happening right on the sun's surface, due to the intense electric fields and currents. Professor Donald Scott suggests that these electric conditions can lead to low-energy nuclear reactions. So instead of the high-energy nuclear fusion of conventional solar physics, he posits its low-energy nuclear reactions occurring in the high current densities in the presence of plasma double layers. That's where the electric potential differences can accelerate ions to energies sufficient for nuclear reaction. Also, according to Professor Scott, the sun's photosphere has structures akin to the junctions in transistors, like PNP or NPN configurations. These regions where electric current is focused could be sites of enhanced nuclear activity due to the concentrated energy and particle interactions. Further, the energy released from these transmutations would contribute to the heat and light of the sun, explaining solar radiation without needing to invoke core fusion. This model suggests that solar energy is not only generated, but also regulated through these surface electrical processes. All that matter being synthesized right there on the surface of the sun is then sent out across the sun's electric field, picking up charge as it accelerates out past the inner planets. A steady stream of stardust to fill our neighborhood with particulates that could actually make your airlock smell like ozone, burnt steak, and welding fumes.
"Rubbish! Crack pottery! Woo of the highest order!"
you may find yourself exclaiming. But we know that when these particulates interact with the air inside spacecraft, during repressurization, for example, the smell could be likened to ozone, welding fumes, or burnt materials due to the chemical reactions involving the ionization of gases and dust particles. The resultant dust or particles from the action happening on the solar surface might include compounds similar to those produced in welding or high-temperature combustion environments on Earth, like polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, PAHs, which are known to have burnt or metallic smells. Now, it's hard to argue that we send our space probes and satellites out with a rather myopic view, looking for all things gravity, but not much in the way of electricity. Magnetic fields may be obvious, but electric fields are notoriously hard to detect, especially when you're not bothering to look for them. If we only design instruments under the delusion that there's no significant electrical activity in space, it shouldn't be surprising that there's a lack of data to support the EU model. It's a case of scientific blinders more than absence of electrical phenomena. So how do we prove whether or not space has a smell? One possibility is to send up a device called an olfactometer, essentially an electronic nose that can capture samples of particulate outside the spacecraft, and then analyze them with chemical sensors to measure intensity, concentration, and sometimes even identify the specific odor-causing compounds present. Why bother, you ask? Well, because if these are the smells of space, then the EU model just hit another successful prediction. Well, kind of. Maybe no one put it in writing beforehand, but these are the exact smells you'd expect to find clinging to your suit, given the scale of electrical activity happening in the solar system. With all those free electrons and ions up there, this may be the expected smell in the standard model as well. So, just a little more confirmation that the electric universe model is valid and continues to align with observations. And that's important when you're dealing in applied cosmology instead of theoretical cosmology. When dealing with real forces that we can directly observe and test, predictive success matters. Big Space likes to remind us that in theoretical modeling, you have to update the theory as you go. However, it violates two critical tenets of the seven-step scientific method: hypothesis and prediction. In other words, nice try. But when you continue to move the goalpost in science, the price is credibility. So what if every probe going up included instruments that can detect, measure, and maybe even sniff for electrical charge activity? Maybe something as simple and inexpensive as a modified Langmuir probe with an olfactometer. Or here's an idea. What about an app for anyone who wants to access the data so we can run experiments down here on the ground? With something as simple as a few tests, we just might be able to say in complete confidence, yeah, space does smell like a cosmic barbecue. Now we know why.